Dave. Fuck you.
Oh, come on, man.
It's early.
It is early, isn't it?
What are you, TMZ? You know what? Someone actually just told me what TMZ stands for.
30 mile zone, right?
I never knew that.
I just found that out.
Why would I know that?
Pretty recently. What's going on, man?
Well, we were just trying to figure out when the last time we were here was. It's been like almost 10 years.
It was right when you guys were releasing In Your Honor.
Yeah. You got any fucking donuts or nothing here?
Yeah, we got some.
What the fuck?
We got some healthy stuff, I think.
You got healthy donuts?
Yeah.
That's cool. Not us.
You know what I like to do? I like to melt Advils onto my donuts. Phooey, what the fuck?
What's up, man? Good to see you.
How you been?
It's been a long time.
What's up? 10 years almost.
I know. Has it been 10 years?
Yes.
I feel like it has not been that long.
So you guys have not been here since we're at South.
We haven't been here since One by One, and that record came out in 2002.
Yep. 9 years ago.
Well, good to see you guys. I'm glad to be back. Good, man. Everything's going well.
Yeah?
I know things are going well for you, too.
Well, fuck, you've been here for how long?
January started our 6th year. So we finished 5 at the end of December, and now we're starting with the beginning of our 6th year.
Really? You can't get any new decorations?
Put up the old shit?
They think that's good.
I mean, I recognize, dude. God rest his soul.
God rest his soul.
And here's our good friends, Dave Grohl and Taylor Hawkins of the Foo Fighters. They were just on Saturday Night Live. I was watching them, and they were really, really good. Their album went to number one on the alternative charts, which is rare these days because a lot of rock bands aren't doing well.
Well, the alternative chart. It's not.
Hey, look at this.
How are you? It's not the Hot 200 or whatever it is. Hey, Taylor.
Hey, Taylor. What's happening, man?
Hi.
Good to see you. Hey, Dave, I was just saying, I saw you on Saturday Night Live for 2 excellent songs.
Yeah, that's great.
Oh, now.
Very nice. Very nice job.
We were trying to figure out how long it's been since we've been here.
It's been like 10 years.
No, it hasn't been that long. It hasn't been that long. I've seen you guys
like
around.
5 years.
Maybe 5 years.
Someone was saying that last time we were here, someone had to, took a banana and gave it a blowjob just so he could hang out with us.
Yeah, but he said fillet it or something.
Filleted it.
Filleted it.
Yes. Someone filleted it.
I think he's like, someone had to fillet a banana. I'm like, what does that mean?
I was watching Saturday Night Live, and the first thing I was thinking about, when you perform with the Foo Fighters, you shake your head so violently when you play.
I don't understand
how you don't have like a whiplash condition or your neck doesn't hurt.
Brought to you by Advil.
Thank you very much.
Is that true? Because it's like
3 Coors Lights and 3 Advils.
No, but be honest with me. You shake your head violently when you play. Yeah. Does that hurt you?
No.
It doesn't at all. You don't feel it.
It kind of does like for the first couple days of the tour.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Have you ever had a whiplash where you had to wear a neck brace afterwards?
It's not that bad.
Is it true that you are almost deaf from playing rock music?
My left ear is almost gone.
Now, why don't you wear the ultimate ears like people wear on stage?
Because it looks so stupid.
Lame.
I gotta cool say.
What, you know,
You're using the old monitors?
They wear them like decorations.
Yes,
you know?
But wait a second.
Yeah, when they stick out like, all...
But wait a second.
But those are worse for you, I think, Howard.
Wait a second.
I'll tell you what the weirdest part is. When you have those things on, just as you have these headphones on...
Right.
There's no sonic perspective. So if I have these off and you're talking to me, I know that you're right in front of me. But if I turn around, I can hear your voice behind me. Those things just put everything in the middle of your brain. It's really weird.
But as a guy who does radio and I have to use my voice 4 hours a day, wearing the headphones, I can lower my voice. I put compression on the microphone.
Right.
It saves my voice that I can actually talk because otherwise I feel strained. So there were certain things. I mean, you say lame. You use the comment lame, Taylor, that, it's not rock and roll. It's not cool. But if Dave is deaf, it's over. I mean, the guy's a great musical
writer.
But
you're saying those earphones are going to save his
ears?
Yes, sometimes those can be worse.
Why? Why would it be worse?
Because it's right in your ear canal hole.
Yeah, remember like when Walkmans got all popular and then people were like, oh, you got to chill out on those because kids are going deaf and, you know.
Doesn't that scare you, though?
That happened?
Doesn't that scare you that you might be deaf?
Yeah, sometimes. But it's kind of nice. Like, if, you know, if my kids are running around and they're going bananas,
yeah.
I sleep on this ear because this one's gone.
Right.
I actually get a little rest.
Do you think that, and Taylor, is your hearing okay?
Huh?
Is your hearing
we knew
okay?
That one was coming. This
is it okay?
Yeah, you know, no, it is actually. I don't know why. I do think it's kind of hereditary. I think some people go deaf a lot easier than others.
And because I haven't seen you guys in a long time, I was looking over Dave, and Taylor, you haven't gone this route, but I was watching the appearance on Saturday Night Live, and I was really happy that the songs were so good, because there's not a lot of good rock music being made anymore. Or if it is, it doesn't get much attention.
Yeah, you don't hear it on the radio. Yeah.
And so, and it's hard now with the way the business is to actually make money selling records and distribute your records. The whole thing's kind of weird, I would think, to be in the music business right now.
Wild West.
But the thing I noticed, too, is that you've heavily tattooed yourself.
Not too bad.
Wait a second. Both arms.
Well,
now
I guess,
big...
yeah, since I've last been here.
I have a progression.
I have a couple tattoos here. I have tattoos here.
Two big, like, angel wings on your... what are those two big blotches?
They're raven feathers. They're like big crow feathers.
Let me see those. Two big crow feathers on each arm.
Miss Kat Von D did these.
Why crow feathers?
Well, I think that crows and ravens are kind of magical, weird animals that they go back in Nordic mythology, and
right.
They're communal, and it's kind of
cool. I didn't know any of this.
You didn't know any of that?
No,
well, so I thought they were cool, and I had some old messed up tattoos that I wanted to fix.
Right. Oh.
And Kat's a friend of mine, and she's an amazing tattooist, but she's also a really cool chick, you know. And I called her up, and I said, I want to fix my tattoos, and I went in there, and she said... I said, I'm thinking about doing something with, like, black sort of crow feathers. She's like, great. And so she went online, and she found this beautiful image, and then she made it this big. And I said, well, would it fit right there? She's like, that's a perfect place to do it. And she said, would you do it on the other arm, too? I said, absolutely.
I saw that. Then you have one on your forearm. I couldn't tell what that was. I like that. And then on your upper arms are, like, big red designs and things that are happening. And I thought, wow, something's going on with you. Like, you're bored or something, and you keep marking up your body more. Like, you have a lot of time to get all these tattoos,
well,
Dave.
You know, to be honest, when I got the red tattoos on my arms, that was when I first started playing drums again. And I thought, like, oh, I'm going to get these things on my arms because I got my arms back, you know.
Right.
And then these things, I kind of got
the feathers.
I was in this band called Them Crooked Vultures.
Right.
And it was me and John Paul Jones from Zeppelin and Josh from Queens of the Stone Age. And, you know, you always see pictures of yourself playing drums where you're going like this.
Yes.
And I just thought, like, how badass it would be if I had these two
big tattoos. Taylor, you don't have any tattoos. I'm shocked by
that. I have this one, and I have, like, 15 past girlfriends tattooed over right there. I just kept getting them tattooed. And finally, when I got married, I just said...
You got married?
Yeah, yeah.
You're kidding me.
When did that happen? You have been gone a long time.
Shock and regret.
Who the hell did you marry?
A beautiful lady.
Mrs. Hawkins, man.
Miss Hawkins.
Kidding.
Allison
She's the real
Hawkins.
Deal.
Yeah, she's a tough woman, too. Let me tell you what modeling agency
is she with?
My personal one.
Virginia Beach.
Dave, you never went the model route. Your wife was a TV producer, right?
Yeah, but she was, to be honest, she was a model.
She was a model, too.
Yeah, she was.
Is that mandatory that rock stars have to marry models?
No, because, you know, the problem is a lot of times...
Yeah.
Rock dudes aren't very good looking, so they're with models, and they're like, okay, we know why you're with him.
Right, right.
There's no question why you're with him.
Yeah.
So, but, I mean, that is great to have sex with somebody that good looking, no?
It's awesome.
It's awesome. I mean,
having sex with beautiful people totally rules.
Absolutely.
Yeah. See, I think it's scary.
I mean, ugly people, it's fun to have sex with them, too, but, like, it's even better when they're hot.
Oh,
so you're confirming that it's better.
It's better when they're hot. You look down, and it's all hot, too. It's not just hot up here. It's hot all, you know.
On the new album, this is your seventh studio album, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So on the new Foo Fighters album, you brought back in this guy, Pat Smear.
Yeah.
Pat had left the band. Then he came back to the band. Then I think he left the band. And then he came back again. Like, why is he allowed to do that? And Taylor, don't you wonder that too? Why?
Because he's really fun.
He's fun, and he's a great lead guitar player. But don't you already have a lead guitar player?
Well, basically the way it worked, he was on... The first record I did by myself, and it was just me playing all the instruments. Then the second record, Pat played on that album with us. And the first 2 years of the band, we were on the road the entire time.
Right.
Now, Pat's a little bit older than us, you know. He's 50, I guess.
Mid-50s now.
So when he joined this band, he wasn't like a little kid, you know.
Right.
And we toured like we were little kids.
Right.
And after like a year and a half, he just got really sick of it. And in his nicest voice, he said, "You guys, I just don't want to be in the band anymore." And we're like, "What?" And I begged him to stay.
But who leaves a successful band? I mean, you know how difficult. This is a miracle that you've been in two successful bands, Nirvana and Foo Fighters.
Yeah.
It's a miracle. You know that.
Yeah.
It's a very difficult business. Why would this guy leave when the money's finally starting to
roll in? That's one of the cool things about Pat.
He doesn't care.
No, he doesn't give a
that's
shit.
That's not his vibe.
He does not care.
Don't people like that scare the shit out of you?
One of those guys that, like, whenever... I think back then, he would get, like, really close to success and then he would, like, sabotage it.
So when you bring in Pat Smear to be on the new album, the guy who is the lead guitar player...
Chris,
what did he think of that?
You know, I mean, honestly, he wasn't really too stoked about it.
And how do you say that to him? You say, "Hey, listen, Chris, you're not good enough to be our only lead guitar player."
No, here's how it worked. Pat split. After Pat split, we got another guy, an old friend of mine. He was in for maybe 8 months.
You haven't seen the movie yet, have you?
You got to see the movie.
No.
All these questions would be answered.
Yeah. Well, wait a second. You walked up to a guy and said, "Chris, I hate to tell you this, but I'm bringing in another lead guitar player."
We were doing this acoustic tour.
Right.
Okay. And we made a record in 2005 that was a double album. So one record was rock. The other record was acoustic stuff.
Right.
And there was just additional instrumentation. There was like strings and vibes and more like 20 guitar parts, and so we needed to get another. We built this extended band, and we needed another guitar player. And Pat and I have always been friends,
right?
So I thought, let's have Pat come back and do it.
But why couldn't Chris do it?
Well, because we needed more guitar players. I mean, Chris would do his part, and I would do my part, and then
I would feel awful if I was the lead guitar player. I would feel they're telling me I'm not good enough.
It was tense.
No, it was a little awkward. I basically said, I just went to each person and said, "What do you think?" And they're like, "Okay. Just make sure Chris is cool with it. What do you think?" "Okay, make sure Chris is." And then I asked Chris.
And he wasn't cool.
I'm not cool with it.
He was like, "I got to be honest. I feel a little weird."
Yeah, but I...
Then how did it happen?
Well, because
Dave's the boss. It's ultimately up to you, right?
Well,
this is your band.
I said, "Look, let's try."
Right.
"Let's try. You can't..." I mean, that's
what
one of the things...
What does try mean? In other words...
Try means
don't,
I come
try
in,
not
if
being
it
on
turns into like a fist fight or whatever, then
right.
Maybe it's not a good idea.
Is it a drain being the boss of the Foo Fighters? Mean, as much as it's great that you write the songs...
It's kick-ass.
It's kick-ass. It's not a drain on you that you have to turn to people and say, "Look, you're out on this solo. I'm taking it away from Chris and I'm giving it to Pat."
Well,
yeah, but Pat doesn't play guitar solos.
Yeah.
Well, the truth of the matter is... Yeah. It really works out really good.
There is a place for him.
Dave's the perfect rhythm guitar player because he's a great drummer, obviously. So he's got this perfect rhythm guitar playing. Chris is like the color. Chris adds the leads, and he's the color on top. And
don't get me wrong. It works. When I heard this stuff on Saturday Night Live, I said, "Wow, this sounds really good."
Pat's the dirty, scrappy, undertone, true... I mean, he's from the Germs. He's from the original LA punk rock band. So he adds a lot of... He's the gutter. He's the gutter of the Foo Fighters.
Sometimes when you're screaming at the top of your lungs, I get fearful that you're going to lose your voice. Does that
you're
hurt
so
your throat?
You're so worried about me, Howard. I love it.
You're
so good, dude.
Does it hurt your throat?
Concerned.
I am.
These aren't questions I get all the time.
You know,
how much pussy did you get on the road?
No, forget the pussy on the road for a second. I we'll get to that.
Okay.
But do you blow out your throat when
Absolutely.
You do. And you don't give any thought to like, "Wow, I want my voice to last for the next 20 years.
You know, I'm a little more in the moment with that kind of stuff. Like, I should take care of my voice better. I should take care of my ears better. But to me, you know, I'll know when it's time to stop.
You think, "Oh, I'll be in my 50s, it'll be time to stop." But you might be 50 going, "You know what, I'd like to go play a tribute to Paul McCartney, or I'd like to play a tribute to someone," and then your voice will be gone.
I hope that before that happens, I'll figure it out. Right now, I'm still doing okay. I mean, for years, like, it's been the same thing.
I try, dude.
You do. This is an issue. What do you do? What do you say?
Before we went on to Saturday Night Live, because I sang the backgrounds, and I'm having my little throat coat tea, and I'm like, 170? Come on. And he's sitting there drinking his Bud Light. He was like, no, get out of here.
You are a lot of fun, Taylor, to watch. When I see the group perform, it's very dynamic between you and Dave. People don't realize how much singing you actually do behind Dave. You actually sit there and harmonize him while you play the drums. And you apparently need to wear shorts when you play. Why is that? You can't wear pants?
Because I grew up, I'm from Laguna Beach. I grew up, on the beach, basically, and I always played in surf trunks. And I still just wear surf trunks every day, anyways.
No underpants, just the surf trunks?
No.
And your balls are hanging all over you.
Free flowing, dude.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So, Dave, I don't understand something about you. I don't understand how you became this great guitar player. You were in Nirvana, you were the drummer.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, now you're this front man with a guitar. And I don't understand how you made that transition. Did you take up the guitar after?
No. Guitar was my first instrument.
Well, Pat's got a great story about that.
Huh.
He said that him and Kurt were walking backstage at a Nirvana show or whatever, and you were sitting in a dressing room like playing the guitar or something like that, and then Kurt and Pat were walking by and they listened to Dave playing guitar and like, we're not even the best guitar players in the band.
I mean, I started playing drums because the drummer in the band that I was in as a kid just wasn't really that great.
Did you start?
So let me do that.
Were you a musical prodigy? Were you a kid who at like 10 years old could play every instrument, something like that? I get that feeling.
No, but I could figure stuff out, like I could hear a song and I would know, I could see it where, how to play it in my mind, and then I would just be able to.
Did you take formal lessons? Did your parents get you piano lessons or guitar lessons?
No. But both of my parents were musical, so I think that, like, my father was a classically trained flautist, and he's got, like, pitch and a great ear.
So your father playing the flute didn't say to you, son, I want you to have music lessons. I want you to learn how to read music. You don't know how to read music.
No.
You do this all by ear.
Yeah.
And so when you're growing up and you're in bands, your parents are probably encouraging you to do this because they understood the world of music.
Well, the bands that I was in when I was a teenager were like crazy hardcore punk rock bands. Like, right. I practically worshipped the devil when I was a teenager.
Were you a bad student?
Absolutely.
Terrible.
Totally.
Didn't graduate high school.
I dropped out. I dropped out to go on the road when I was 17.
But you're from a musical family.
Yeah.
And so, and also probably a middle class family, right?
Yeah, middle lower class family.
Were they kind of disgusted with you and like, wow, why aren't you going to go to college?
Well,
son?
My dad, my father is, he's more conservative, right? So we lived in D.C. and he was kind of like a Capitol Hill guy. He was a speech writer and he was a campaign manager and he was a journalist and super intellectual. My mother was a high school English teacher for 35 years. So she was more liberal, but equally brilliant. And
you tell a high school English teacher you're going to drop out of school?
Yeah.
And what do they say? No way.
Just get a job and you better be good at music.
You're kidding me.
No.
You mean you said, look, I've got the music in me. There's no question about
it. She knew.
And they don't force you to stay in school.
No.
You're that strong-willed that you knew you could leave school. Like, my parents would have just kicked my fucking ass.
Oh, yeah. I wouldn't be here. I'd be dead.
Did you go to college?
No. Junior college.
Yeah, right. So, okay.
What is junior college? I don't even know what that is. They teach you, like, how to bang a sheet metal? Or is that what that is?
It's where you go to fuck girls. It's
like
art. That's right. So, wait a second.
Stupid.
You drop out of high school at 17. Were you the cool kid in high school?
Absolutely not.
How do you meet Kurt Cobain and form Nirvana with him? Although, you were the sixth drummer in the band.
Yeah, I came later.
Why did they go through five other drummers before they came to find you?
They were a funny band, I think they hadn't really found the right drummer yet. And, the way Kurt wrote songs, he wrote these really, really simple songs. And he's a great lyricist, but his objective was really, like, make the song as catchy and memorable and simple as possible.
Did he allow you any feedback in the writing process? I mean, here you are, a great songwriter.
We wouldn't even talk about it. We would just go in the room, and he'd start playing something, and we'd just play along, and then it would become a song. We wouldn't say, like, that chorus needs to be twice as long and in a different key.
You wouldn't question him. So he was the leader of that band.
The idea was not even to talk about music, to keep it as pure as possible.
Did it frustrate you that Kurt Cobain had that much? I mean, here you are. You're a bit of a control freak. You have all of these songs inside of you. And then Kurt Cobain.
Describing you?
How did you function in that band?
It's great.
But it's almost like being George Harrison. George Harrison had great songs. The Beatles made him only have one song on an album. Kurt wouldn't let you have
But he was in a band with Lennon and McCartney. And I was in a band with Kurt. So it's that famous joke. Like, what's the last thing the drummer said before he got kicked out? I got a song I think we should play.
Yeah, right.
You know, that doesn't, you can't. And yeah. I was perfectly happy because I was just, I was like disco drumming. I was just going doosh, dash, doosh, doosh, dash. I wasn't.
But didn't you have all these great songs in your head that you had written? I mean, you wrote great songs for Foo Fighters.
Well, I lived with this friend of mine, and we had an 8-track studio in the basement. So I just go record by myself in the basement.
Did you ever say to Kurt, listen, I've got great songs?
No.
You would not do that.
You never let him hear anything you wrote?
He heard some, and he liked a couple of them. There were two that he really liked he wanted to do, but he was afraid to ask me if he could change the lyrics.
Do you think if Kurt hadn't died, you'd still be in Nirvana and never have written any of your songs that you wrote for Foo Fighters and never have gone out and done it? Like, in a his death liberated you in a weird sense, right?
I mean, I know that I would still be recording and writing stuff of my own. Because that's one of the great... Taylor does the same thing. It's like everybody in this band goes out and does side projects.
Right.
You know? So when they come back to this, it's the Foo Fighters. And then...
But you weren't doing that when you were in Nirvana. You weren't doing side projects.
Well, I was, but I just wasn't letting anyone hear it.
Because I think...
Because I was nervous about it.
But don't you think that might have even ruined Nirvana? Like, you were the guy in Nirvana who played drums. And all of a sudden, you go off and do your own thing. It breaks up the band. You might never have really... blossom. We might not know you that well.
It would be, if things had been different, things would be different for sure.
When he killed himself, were you immediately in a depression or did you see it? You were.
Yeah.
And did you say to yourself, that's it, it's the end of my career, I'm never going to go anywhere?
Yep.
Did you sit and meet with Chris, the other guy in Nirvana, and say, should we form a band together? I always thought it was no, because that would have been weird.
Yep.
You two guys with some new frontman.
It was way too heavy. We've never talked about that, ever. It's been 20 years. We still haven't talked about it.
So when Kurt dies, what's your game plan? Or you don't have one? You start to drift?
Yeah, I just, you know.
Who tells you your lead singer's gone? I mean, how do you find that out?
I don't even remember who told me. I remember the day, but I don't remember who. I think maybe it was on the news or something weird. I don't know. I don't remember
You didn't get a call. You just heard it.
I think it happened, and then it just all happened, like, and the phone's off the hook. And
people are calling this and that.
Yeah.
And what do you do that day? You just go into shock. I mean, you can't go back.
Everybody got together. Everybody went over to Chris Novoselic's house and, you know.
Hung out. Because you were there comforting one another.
Yep.
And no one says to each other, what are we going to do now? But it's got to be in your mind. At some point, it hits you, like, what am I doing with the rest of my life?
It was just such a weird time. And we were kids, you know. I was, like, 25 years old or something like that.
Yeah.
So it was just, it was strange. And nobody, I couldn't listen to music. I couldn't listen to Nirvana. I couldn't listen. I'd turn on the radio, and I'd hear, like, all by myself. I start crying, you know. It was terrible.
Yeah. Did you go into therapy after that?
Yeah.
You did.
You know, I was in therapy before that for my first marriage because I was married to someone who was like, we should go. The idea was that the two of us go to different therapists and then we all get together at some point.
How much therapy can you go through? that's a lot of therapy, right? So fortunately, you were able to go to therapy and through that and talk to someone about it.
Yeah, it was good.
And what was the thrust of that? Like, what should I do with the rest of my life? I mean, once you come off the initial shock.
Well, I mean... You know,
you almost joined Tom Petty.
Yeah.
What'd you do?
Well, I played with Tom Petty on Saturday Night Live. Right. That was really the first thing I did. I mean, the first thing I did, I started getting calls asking if I wanted to play drums with other bands. I'm like, no, man, I don't want to play. I don't even know if I ever want to play drums again.
Not after you played drums for Nirvana. It would have been sort of weird.
Yeah, and I mean, just sitting down at a drum set reminded me of Kurt. It reminded me of Nirvana, and it was just sad. So,
was it all good with Kurt? I mean, were you on
things
good terms?
Things got weird towards the end.
So did that make you feel even weirder about his death because things got so weird? Were you sort of estranged?
Yeah, I mean, everybody sort of was, I think, at that point. It had sort of split off, and it just got really weird.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know if anybody really does, but it had gotten to the point where...
He wasn't talking to you?
Well, they were just... You know, I don't... I don't do drugs.
Right.
I haven't done drugs since I was a kid.
Right.
20 years old, I think, is when I stopped. And so, you know, there were drugs around. And there was, like, the people who did the drugs, and then there were people that didn't do the drugs. And I didn't do the drugs. And so I was just out of that world, you know. And if you're in it, you're in it. If you're not, you're out.
Well, it reminds me, I got into the iPhone, and John Hine was in an Android, and I wasn't hanging out with
him. You see how that split you guys up?
Everyone who's onto the iPhone was my
friend.
Isn't
that weird how that works?
Yeah, I know. But in all seriousness, that's true. The drugs become alienating in the sense that when you're into the drug culture, you want to hang out with other guys who do drugs.
You don't care about anyone but yourself at that point.
I know.
That's how it works.
So in the last couple of months, you hadn't even been in touch with Kurt.
No, we had.
Right.
And but
were you close to breaking up the band anyway? Do you think you guys would have broken up because Kurt was going his own way?
I think at that point it was important that we take a break. I think everybody felt that way. It was like time to take a break.
Does it personally hurt you when Courtney Love goes around spouting off that Kurt hated you at the end? You were his least favorite person. He didn't like. I mean, she goes around with stories and some of the stories.
I mean, still, that was all drugs.
Yeah,
it had nothing to do with. If it were true,
honestly,
it's a mean thing to say because you did. Of course, you had a relationship with Kurt and you made great music together. It's hurtful.
The way I look at it is I have my version of what happened, and I have my memories, and Pat and I talk about that stuff all the time, and we laugh about the good times, and we talk about the bad times sometimes, but, you know, it's those kind of, you can't really let those things get to you.
You're able to hold on to your version of it. You don't let her version of things kind of, because
how
I know.
How much was she around? Was she there all the time?
Yeah, they were married, you know.
I don't know. I'm just asking.
I get very offended, probably too much. I lose my own opinion sometimes. When somebody does that, they ruin my experience.
Right.
You know, and it hurts me.
Well, not really so much for me, because you also have to understand that the circumstances are so extraordinary that everybody's got their version of what happened, you know? It's such a public event, that whole thing. It's not like my buddy Jimmy passed away, and, you know, nobody really knew Jimmy, but something like that that's so out in the open, you kind of can't really, you have to guard yourself from all of the outside stuff, because it's just too crazy.
Have you ever sat her down and said, listen, Courtney, look, I got no animosity with you. I had a great thing going with your ex-husband, you know, your husband. And why can't you stop this? Why?
No.
You've never done that.
No.
Because why? It would be useless?
Because I got better stuff to do, you know what I mean?
Like, I mean,
have this
really,
great
would it
band
help, Howard?
I have kids and I have this wonderful life. Like,
that does. But
why
but
would I want to like, focus on that stuff?
I'll tell you why. Because I know you have to do business with her, right? Let's say you found a Nirvana concert in a vault somewhere where you wanted to release it right now. You would have to go to her, right? I assume.
Well, it's not like I would call her. And
some business guy would.
Right. That's kind of
how
it
works.
But
then you know she would see that you wanted something, so she would right away kind of say, I'm not doing that.
Well, you know, I think at the end of the day, whenever any of that business stuff comes up, everybody, no matter how weird things are, everybody kind of holds Nirvana as, like, that's the priority. The music and the band, that's the priority. And it doesn't matter what else is going on. It's like, this is great. This is, you want people to remember us for the music. That's the most important thing.
Nobody gets in the way of that.
No, I don't think so.
So when Nirvana ends, were you so wealthy at that point that you could have stopped everything?
Yeah.
You could have, right? Because when I think of Nirvana, I think of Nirvana money for a second. It had to be insane. Three guys, really, when you think about it, touring. Although you guys probably didn't tour that much.
We didn't really tour that much.
But the records, you sold a lot of records.
Sold a lot of records.
And I guess there was enough money there that you could have lived the rest of your life.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, I was 24, 25 years old. I'd never made more than $3.25 an hour, you know? I'd never had I never had salary.
Right.
I'd only worked minimum wage my whole life.
So it's a good idea for us not to go to high school, right? I mean, is that the message today?
Kids,
don't waste
look
your time.
If you have
at
a
how
skill,
awesome
right.
my life schmill. Turned out.
Yeah. Yeah, just play drums or something.
Well, that's a skill.
Think right. about it. Like, honestly, how much do you really need?
I don't know. When you got out of Nirvana, here Kurt is gone, what were you worth?
I don't really even remember.
$100 million?
Oh, no way.
$50 million?
No, not that much.
$25 million?
Not that much either.
$15 million?
Maybe.
All right, so somewhere around $15 million you were worth. It's true. You could have just said, You like that?
that's highball, too.
Wish I was in Nirvana.
Yeah. Man, what were you doing? You dropped out of high school, you maniac.
I was working at a music store.
You're over at that junior college wasting time. Did you ever meet the other five guys who were in Nirvana before you playing
the
drums?
Some of them, yeah.
Are they bitter?
I don't think so. Well, I haven't seen them in a long time. I remember meeting one of them, and he shows up in a monster truck over at the house where Kurt and I lived. He's like, hey, let's go get some beers. And we went down to, this is Olympia, Washington. We went to a grocery store, and next door there was a laundromat. He goes, hey, y'all got a quarter? We go, yeah. He jumps in an industrial-sized dryer and goes, put the quarter in.
Oh, my God.
He got in the dryer and just flipped around for a couple minutes and then knocked on the window. We let him out.
Oh, my goodness.
It's kind of like the Pete Best story. I would love to meet the five other guys who are in Nirvana and what they're doing now. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't that be sort of an interesting TV show?
Well, I know two of them. Chad, I think, was the drummer right before me. Chad lives on, I think he lives in Bainbridge Island, and he's really, you know, he's got his own music thing going, and he's happy.
They should form a band, five drummers all together, just sitting there, like some sort of, I don't know, some kind of drumming thing.
Well, the other one, yeah. Dale Crover, the guy who played drums on the first Nirvana record, he and Chad both played, but he was like my drumming hero. So, and he's on the cover of Modern Drummer. And
why was he not good enough? Did you ever ask Kurt?
Well, he was in another band. He was in Kurt's favorite band, and Kurt would borrow him sometimes.
Oh, I see. So, yeah. So he didn't want to leave his favorite band. Meanwhile, he should have left that favorite band.
Yeah, what was the favorite band?
Yeah.
They called the Melvins.
The Melvins. Isn't it unbelievable the mistakes you can make in life? Like, imagine if you were a guy.
The Melvins kept you.
Imagine if you were a guy who said, you know what? I could go to Nirvana or I could go to the Melvins. I'll choose the Melvins. Like, I mean, you got to be one
fucking. I got to be loyal to the Melvins.
You got
to
be a mess inside. After you make a decision like that.
I think they're all happy people.
Right, Taylor? Because, I mean, you think about it with the drums. You know, you pick the right band, suddenly you got $15 million in the bank.
Yeah.
You pick the Melvins, and you're working at McDonald's to supplement your income.
It's not that
No,
bad.
I think they're doing okay.
They're doing okay.
Oh, the Melvins?
Yeah, they still tour. They really are. Yeah.
They are?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I figure anybody who can make a living doing this is good.
That's okay. Yeah. No, it's all good. So now, all of a sudden, you could have got, I would look at it as freedom. I've got $15 million in the bank, and if I go and do some music now,
there's no risk.
Yeah, at least I've got
my
$15
million. Honestly, that's one of the, the foundation of this band is so perfect because everything that we've done, we've never really been like, we've never had this aggressive financial...
with Foo Fighters.
Yeah,
right.
Like we've always just been mellow, like, let's make it about the music. Let's not talk about money. Let's just go have a good time. And
but what do you mean not talk about money? I mean, Taylor wants to talk about money. He doesn't have $15 million in the
bank. Well, you know, when it's
let's not make it about money for you. But,
we don't get
no. It's cool. We don't need to get paid for that. That's cool. I'm cool with that.
How does it work? You have to determine what Taylor's salary is going to be. You are the boss. That's
Taylor's
what I mean.
Salary.
Well, it's true. Is
$325 an hour, baby?
Is he on salary?
No.
Well, what do you mean no?
No.
He's a member of the band.
He's a member of the band.
Well, what does that mean?
Well, that's how it works in this band. Like.
Equal split for everyone?
Well, equal split for a lot of the stuff, and then there's some stuff that people just get paid for just for being in the band.
And none of the guys are ever unhappy? I mean, Taylor's never once come to you and said, look, I love being in the band, but wait a second here. I'm trying to buy some milk for the kids. You know,
the baby needs shoes.
Yeah, I mean, you are the boss.
Well, you know, also, all of these albums that we've put out, they're on my label, and I just license them to Sony BMG.
Oh, is that it?
Yeah. And so we own our whole catalog. So nobody tells us how to do stuff.
Does Taylor get an annual review where you go, okay, you've done a good job for the year, and here's your bonus?
No, we've never
evaluation.
I don't even know if I'd understand what that is.
Right, because it seems anti-rock and roll to have to be this corporate boss, in a sense, but you are big business. Foo Fighters
I'm
is big business.
I'm not that smart either, so it's hard for me to understand. There's some things that I can do well, and then other things I just go, nah, I don't care what.
So do you leave that to other people? Are there business people?
Absolutely.
That well,
you know, and also, like my manager, I've had the same manager for 21 years. I've had the same accountant for 21 years.
I admire your loyalty. I think you're a very grounded person, and there's not a lot of people in rock and roll who are very grounded. There are a lot of people who are just off their fucking rockers. So, talking about business for a second. So, when this guy from Glee comes to you, and he seems kind of like a mafiosa, he says to you, we want to use the music of the Foo Fighters for the TV show Glee.
Well, let me explain something first.
Okay.
Glee never approached us to do music.
Okay.
That That came up in conversation when we were doing an interview for the Hollywood Reporter.
I was going to ask, is that the way you have to go now in music? You have to go to Glee? You have to go to American Idol?
Well, I think the point I was trying to so eloquently make when I talked about it was that I think it's important that bands don't feel pressured to do that sort of big business thing, you know? Like, we all grew up in garages and garage bands and van tours. And, you know, whenever anybody asks me musical advice, I say, you know what? Just be good at what you do and don't expect much. And if that's not enough, then don't do it, because it's impossible to make it in the music industry. You got to be either really, really good, or you got to be really, really lucky, or both.
Well, there used to be artists who, like The Who, who would say, we would never commercially use our music. We would never put in a commercial. We wouldn't put on a TV show. And they all seem to have shifted because the model changed that, like, that's how you get your music out of here. But it seems to me it's become okay to sell out. I kind of admire that you wouldn't go to Glee. But then the guy from Glee is saying, hey, you know, fuck the Foo Fighters. They almost make it seem like you're homophobic or something if you won't give your music to Glee.
Well, you know, it's funny because I said that, like, man, you know, I said that's not fair that he thinks that everyone should do the show, you know.
Right.
And then the next day I told my manager, I'm like, hey, I kind of said some stuff about Glee. And it was like, oh no, you did. Oh my God, what was it? And then, Elton John came out. I mean, basically, like Slash and the guys from Kings of Leon. I know those guys, like, they're nice guys, you know?
Right.
And the creator of Glee sort of came down hard on them for not agreeing to use the music, right?
Right.
So I was kind of sticking up for them. Like, yeah, you shouldn't have to do that. No, right. Why do you got to do that? And then actually the guy, Ryan Murphy, he recently kind of said, like, you know what? You're right. I was kind of a jerk about it, and I shouldn't have said that.
Yeah,
and
because, I mean, it's almost, when I say the mafia, it's like a tactic. Like, I'm going to pressure you. You're not down with Glee.
If I had a nickel for every time that's happened to us, over the years, I remember one time we were doing something, and we were here in New York City, and someone said, okay, there's that red carpet thing you got to go to. And we had a show that night. I'm like, oh, God, do we really? He's like, yeah, you have to go. And I said, are you telling me that my career is going to end if I don't go walk that red carpet? And they basically said, might.
Oh, wow.
Or a radio show.
Yeah.
There was a radio station in, like, Kansas City or something like that that said, we want you guys to play. And our guitar player at the time, Franz, just had a kid, like 2 days before.
Right.
And I said, we can't make it. And they said, if they don't come and play this radio show, we're going to pull them from all of our playlists.
That's right.
And then they said, well, at least Dave has to come MC it. I said, you know what? I will come MC it.
Right.
And I'm going to stand there on stage and tell everybody, you know, I'm here because your favorite radio station just said, if he doesn't do this, we're going to stop playing it. So it happens to everybody.
But you gotta say
fuck you.
Well, you know, I admire that because as a guy on radio, I've been on the opposite end of that and seen program directors say, listen, let's pull them from every radio station in the country.
It's happened.
They don't comply. And you're next thing you know, you're at the jingle ball. You know?
16 years we've been in this band. It's happened to us more than once.
And you have to take
a stand. And you just gotta say, fuck you. That's why we're still here.
You absolutely do, and I'll tell you why. Because for every program director, you could end up your entire year touring and doing free jingle balls all over the country. and literally, because they will strong arm you and say, we will run you out of the business.
Right.
But there are certain bands who will say, fuck you, and I'll take my chances. And so I admire that.
I mean, at the end of the day, the most important thing is that you feel creatively satisfied, that the audience is there for you, and that you're happy and healthy. And because, you know what? Had we not made it in this band, we'd still be playing music. We just, you know, we'd be working at McDonald's 40 hours a week.
And we'd then be at bar mitzvahs.
But it would be pretty frustrating. It must be awful to have good music in you and then not have a crowd in front of you. And, you know, you're playing some small bar somewhere.
Sure.
And after a while, everyone starts to look at you like you're kind of loserish because, you know, you're getting near your 40s and then suddenly you're still playing and working at McDonald's.
Yeah, but are you an artist or are you somebody who wants an audience?
That's the thing is you have to ask whenever someone asks for career advice. It's like, well, what are you looking to get out of it, you know?
Right.
Do you want to just play great music and have a good time, or do you want to be a bazillionaire?
Well, when I got into radio, I never thought I'd ever make any money. I actually just liked the idea of being on the radio, and I was pretty sure I'd be a complete failure.
Where did you start?
I started at a radio station in Westchester. It was called Progressive Radio in the Woods.
Because I remember you for when I was in D.C. as a kid.
Right.
Yeah, well, we were there.
But I had already been around about 8-10 years right. before D.C.
You've never seen the movie?
Yeah, I saw the movie.
See it twice. I was brilliant in it.
You were.
So, boys, it's the music industry has changed. You have a new album out.
Yes.
It's a little scary to me. I mean, the days of Nirvana, there wasn't the internet thing going big right. time. When you sold records, everyone had to get that music through the CD. They got to experience that. You put out a record now, it's like if you sell 1 million copies, you're lucky, right?
That would be a big record.
That would be a big record.
That would be a really
Isn't
big record.
Isn't that nuts? Are you angry yeah. about that? Are you upset by that? That all your work is given
we
away.
We sell
free?
Out stadiums now, dude.
So that's how you make your money. But what about
much.
These? But what about these bands who come out now? They don't get the $15 million cushion like Nirvana got.
Because no, not really.
It's pretty sad, right?
Well, I mean, I don't know what it's like to be young and in a band now. I only know what it's like to be in this band. And the way we do it, we just like the new record. We made it in my garage. It was like, how can we make this interesting? How can we do it so that it's not like the last six times we've done it, and how can we do it?
Why do we care that you made it in a garage? Does it make it sound better, the record?
I think so.
Does, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Why? Because it's in a garage?
Because it sounds different than every other record on the radio.
It has character to it.
Yeah.
Plus, we did it to tape. We didn't use any computers or anything like
Why?
That.
Why do we care about that?
Because the last thing in the world you want to hear in a rock and roll band is, imagine if, you know that Pro Tools stuff everyone uses?
Yeah.
Imagine if you put, like, a Beatles album into Pro Tools and smoothed out all the vocals and gritted all the drums to make it sound perfect, it wouldn't swing like a Beatles record, you know?
I see. So by using tape, you have less flexibility and it's more the original sound.
It's kind of like,
so.
You know, rock and roll used to be this really honest thing, and every band had their own feel and their own sound, and you could hear little mistakes every time you listen to the record, a new one every time, or which was the character, which was the fucked up tooth or the weird eye or whatever. Now, when a band makes a record, they go in and they fix all that stuff. So anything that gives something personality is taken out.
So this is in an actual garage. When you say you made it in your garage, you mean you had to go to the garage? You didn't go to the basement? You went to the garage?
Yeah.
Because the garage has good acoustics?
I don't have a basement.
Where is this garage? I mean, where are you living?
My house.
Your house.
It must be a nice garage. Yeah. It's not like a garage.
This is a fucking studio.
It's got a Learjet in it.
Yeah. Where'd you put the car?
Harleys.
Where do you put your car when you have your band in your garage?
Right around my massive fountain statue in the circular driveway.
Do you have neighbors or do you have a big lot of land? I mean, I would be annoyed.
Bunch of land.
Yeah, because I would be annoyed if I was your neighbor and all night long.
And you're making a record.
Thing.
I'd be like, fucking musicians.
They're a quarter of a mile away. It's
I'd
fine.
Be like, hey, I got to go to bed at 8 o'clock at night. I don't want to hear you guys playing all night.
No.
And when you make a record now in a garage, does it like does Taylor go in and do his own drums by himself?
Yeah.
Or does the whole band get together and record the thing at once?
Well, the way we did it is we had Taylor in the garage, and then I had my office upstairs, which turned into the control room. And so I would play guitar up there. We tried to isolate everything. So Nate
so
and I would
So you go up
play
in the bedroom.
There.
Taylor's in the garage.
It's like a Partridge Family.
Yeah, we're all on headphones. And
it sounds like fun.
Wow.
It was great.
Does your wife get annoyed?
No.
She was cool.
Don't you need... We have to talk about chicks. Don't you need new, young chicks in your life to inspire this music? It is about youth. It is about...
I can't write about chicks anymore.
Those are your girlfriends. Oh, I didn't realize. You have wives and girlfriends.
I can't... It's hard for me to write about chicks.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, Nirvana didn't write about chicks, right?
I never really wrote about chicks.
You never did?
That song Everlong was about a chick.
Who was that about? The first wife?
That song was about a girl that I was dating right after my divorce.
It's one of your best songs. Maybe you should write about chicks. I like it.
I got to say that song probably became most famous because of the acoustic version I did here.
The one you did.
I'm not kidding.
That
like
was
being
great.
Here and doing that. That's
we
why
owe you.
Owe you like $10 million.
I owe you because... Okay, I'll take it.
No.
I owe you because it was one of those highlights that we played over and over again.
I can't even believe it.
I mean, does she know it's about her?
Other people picked up on it.
What was so great about this? You were really in love with her and she dumped you?
No.
No? What?
No.
What
Come
happened?
On. Come on.
Bad, bad.
I had just gone through a divorce and we were dating and I realized, like, what am I... Why did I...
Why am I getting married again?
Yeah, it just wasn't the right time.
So you said to her, listen, as great as you are, I have to leave you because I need to go out and experience strange.
It's just the worst. I mean, it's the worst time to get to
the rebound chick. Yeah,
it's the worst time to get together with someone for serious.
What agency was she with?
She was not a model.
She was not a model.
She's unbelievably beautiful, but not a model.
Does your current wife, your wife, have a song about her that you've written?
Oh, yeah.
You say current wife, like there's going to be more.
Well, of course there's going to be more.
The night I met my wife, I said, oh, you're my future ex-wife. And when she gave me her number, it said, Jordan, your future ex-wife.
Your first wife probably got to benefit from Nirvana even more than you did. I mean, she probably walked away with half the Nirvana money, no?
Halfsies.
Halfsies, right? Because you didn't have a prenup at that point. When you got married the first time, you were not...
I don't know if I'm contractually obligated to be able to talk about it. I think I might...
You still can't even talk
might
about
not
it.
Be able to,
but you lost...
I'm sure you understand.
Yes, I do. Oh, I understand very well. But you lost a lot of money there, I would imagine, right?
At that point, that totally didn't even matter to me.
Really?
Yeah, not at all.
See, I would have written a whole album about that. I'm way different than you. Oh, so you, after your first marriage, you went out and you had some fun.
I had some fun, sure.
You had some fun. You met a lot of great women.
He was single for a long time.
I mean, Taylor taught me how to do it because I didn't even know how to do it.
I had just joined the band, and the band was sort of like... holding on a little bit to this sort of punk rock ethos, like, you know, no chicks backstage.
Yeah, we don't like chicks.
Yeah, and all that. And I said, fuck that, dude. You're in Nirvana, man. Let's go get laid.
Yeah, because Nirvana was sort of the anti, like, we're not
rock
Zeppelin.
Stars,
we don't,
yeah.
We're not David Lee Roth, where we go and point out the chicks in the audience and bring them backstage.
I mean, when
that.
I was 18,
yeah,
I could never get chicks when I was 18. There's no way. And then I got into Nirvana, and it wasn't about that at all. And then the Foo Fighters started, and I was married.
Right.
And then we go out on the road, and then the marriage ends, and Taylor's like, let me show you how to do it.
Yeah. So, Taylor, I never thought you would get married in a million friggin' years. I mean, what happened
Oh, dude,
here?
I can't be fucking, you know, 40 years old trolling, you know, titty
See,
bars.
See, that's what's sad. The last thing you want to be is a 40-year-old guy, like, you know, at Scores, like, inviting right. people, you know.
So you settled down. Where'd you meet this girl?
At my house.
At your house.
Yeah. Well, how does that happen?
He just hung a sign on it.
Oh, I see. Okay.
She came into my house, and we were having, like, a little get together, and a buddy of mine said, I'm bringing my wife's best friend over. And
nice.
She came over, and my house had been on, I was on one of the first episodes of Cribs. And I'm telling you, I bought my first house, which we live in now, was like just some 70s track house. And the first thing she did was she walked into the house and she goes, this house wasn't on fucking Cribs. This place is a dump. That was the first thing I ever heard my wife say to me. So.
And when she walked in, was she dressed very hot? Did she have the...
Hell yeah.
What did she have on? Like a mini skirt or
she
something?
Just looked, yeah, something.
She looked good.
She looked good. She's got a body for days.
And lucky her, now she lives in that dumpy track house.
Yeah, she
didn't get any better.
She made us do it. They did a little renovation.
Yeah, she remodeled the shit out of that.
They did a little remodel.
Yeah, she knew what she needed. Yeah. Bigger closets, this kind of thing.
You know what the best, like, this huge remodel, and then you know what Taylor does? He builds a grotto. Yeah. He's got like a Playboy grotto by the pool.
Oh, are you kidding?
It's so good.
Yeah, you know, I had to at least have a little bit of that.
There had to be a little bit of Taylor in
that. It's a man cave. It's a man cave.
Yeah. Exciting.
It's a cave.
It's exciting. So how long has this marriage been going on?
We're like 5 or 6 years in.
And there's kids involved?
Oh, yeah.
No
See,
kidding.
We haven't seen them in a long time.
We grew up, guys.
Do you guys hang out with each other when you're not making music, or is it just basically
play dates with the kids?
You know what? We're
play
together
days.
So much
right.
on the road and in the studio that really the only time that we get away from each other is those weeks, well, week or two in between.
I see. So you have your own
So
lives.
It's like, get the fuck away. Me and Dave go out and mountain bike together.
Is it possible that you guys are good dads, or are you really absentee dads?
No,
let's be honest. Wait a second.
Dads.
We're on the road all the time.
We got the kids with us right now.
Is that right?
Oh,
where
and,
are the
and
kids
Saturday
right
Night
now?
Live, dude.
Yeah.
We went for our sound check, and all of the fucking kids were there. It was
They're never
going
to have us back. That's the last time. Yeah. They'll never
it
ask
was
us
annoying.
Back.
It was insane.
There was like 14 children.
You know what I love about Saturday Night Live, and I watched it, and I still to this day, starting from when I used to watch it when I was in college, The last couple of minutes when everyone's just standing on the stage, I never get tired of watching that. Helen Mirren's there, and she's with Foo Fighters, and she's obviously well rehearsed. She knows not to say the Foo Fighters. She says Foo Fighters.
Foo Fighters are here.
Yeah, Foo Fighters are here. and like you're all standing on stage, and it's such an interesting dynamic to see everyone
who hugs who.
How the cast members like hug each other. Yeah, the cast members hug each other.
They've seen each other all
what
week.
The fuck?
Yeah,
you guys don't like each other. Come on.
Yeah, it's weird. And then I notice certain cast members will come up to the band, the Foo Fighters, and start hugging different guys. And then there are other cast members who kind of keep their distance.
We know some of them. Yeah. Some of them we don't. So we usually hug the people we know first.
Yeah.
That's kind of how it works.
It's a weird dynamic, but it's
is
fun
it up to
watch.
You to make the move?
It's pretty awkward.
Or it is up to the cast members?
I don't know.
I could swear you almost backed off one of them.
Yeah.
Is there pressure to hug, though? I mean, do you feel obligated?
You should hug.
It's part of it.
I always go say hi to the band, too.
You know, it's a big week.
Yeah, that's the other thing. Is it weird to be there and play in front of another band? Like, because those guys are musicians and they're looking at you envious.
Yeah,
and
we're cool. We're bros.
Yeah,
with
we like
them.
Those guys.
I know that drummer. We've done that show so many times that I'm always like, hey, what's up? I check out what kind of cymbals he's using and all that kind of shit.
Yeah, the music sounded really good on there because I hadn't heard the new album and I didn't know what was going on with it. I should plug Foo Fighters' new album Wasted Light featuring the single Rope is in stores tomorrow. For additional information and tour dates, go to foofighters.com. I guess I'll let you guys out of here. I don't know. I should probably play one of the songs. Should I play a little bit of Rope?
Sure.
What does this mean, Rope? I don't understand. What does it mean?
What are we talking about?
What does it mean?
I don't know. That song, we wrote it about 4 years ago at a sound check, and I started writing lyrics for it. And
you wrote this 4 years ago?
The instrumental is about 3-4 years ago.
Yeah, we're Australia, I think.
Yeah.
Is that what happens when you write a song like this? You have an instrument, you have the music in your head, so to speak, and then what do? You put it down.
And then it becomes a melodic idea. Then I start thinking, okay, well, this is how I would sing it, and then I write lyrics to sort of
Me back. It's 4 years ago you wrote that thing, so it's not constantly in your head. What do? Do you hum it into a tape recorder? Because you don't write music. You don't know how to write down the notes.
Well, if it's memorable enough to actually, if you can remember it, it might be worth keeping.
You don't get neurotic where you say,
I don't have anything with me right now?
My music comes to me in the shower.
Right.
And so that's where I do most of my writing. So and whacking my pud. Yeah. Let's say you're in the shower. I don't know if it ever happens to you there. And suddenly this great tune comes into your head.
Yeah.
Okay, for Rope. And then you don't even know it's called Rope yet. I would neurotically run to something, some place I could write it down.
Yeah.
That doesn't occur to you?
I've done it sometimes where like I'll hum it into an answering machine or I'll write it down on a piece of paper, just write the notes, you know.
Oh, so you do know how to write notes?
No, I don't. I just write A, B, C or whatever, you know, chords.
Because you can hear the chords in your head.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. And so, if it's
worth remembering, then use it.
I think I remember reading that when John Lennon and Paul McCartney were writing songs early on, their whole trip was they didn't probably have tape recorders when they were living in Liverpool. They always said if they could remember it the next day,
it was worthwhile.
It was worthwhile.
But that would make me insane. If I had the tune to Yesterday in my head, I would be like, this is so fucking good. And maybe I don't have the words yet, and it's scrambled eggs or whatever the hell it was. But I would be so neurotic. Like, I know I walk around with a piece of paper all the time. I have some ability on a phone or something to write down an idea of some topic I want to do on the air. It's always because
You leave stuff on your cell phone sometimes, don't you?
I do, but I've lost ideas like that before, too.
Yeah, because
like,
if you're walking around...
Idea, I'm so excited about it, and then the next day I can't remember it.
Yeah, and you start doing something else,
but you
it's
see,
gone.
That's the slacker in you. That's the guy who says, I don't leave every dime
on the
table.
I don't know which side of the brain it is that makes you like a good person, but that's the side that doesn't work.
But maybe that makes you the good person that you are because you're not in it for every penny and you're not into it.
And you're not crazy neurotic.
Yeah, you don't seem neurotic.
Definitely not neurotic.
Yeah, that's good. All right.
Thanks.
So Rope came to you about four. I imagine it's about shooting ropes like in a porno.
In a porn?
A big, thick load of
ropes of sperm.
Right, sperm.
Of semen. That should be in parentheses.
What does rope mean? Do you not talk about that?
No, I mean the chorus. It says, "Give me some rope. I'm coming loose."
See,
and so Right.
Coming.
Yeah. You know, yeah. Coming, coming give me loose. Some rope. I'm coming. Like a suicide song?
No, it's more about, you know.
Give me some
a lot of the, a lot of the A lot of the love songs that I've written have had to do with the feeling of being restrained by commitment, but liking it.
Right. But you feel both ways about it. You're committed, and that feels comforting, but also, gee, sometimes I need my space. I need to be free.
Sure.
And that lives inside of you.
Right.
Where is this song wrote, Baba Booey? Let me listen to a little of it. They don't even have it.
Oh, stop.
Oh, here it is. Rope and Gary Page, it's One Green.
You got it?
I got it. Okay. I have it, boys.
Of course they have it.
I like the studio.
Nice,
this
huh?
is really
you
nice.
You've never been so here.
No, this is way... Something.
Shows you. I've made it.
Last way, way dump. Nicer than that dump before.
Yeah, you're not kidding. This is my garage, boys. That's right. This is my garage. Look at his computers, everything. Let me hear a little of this rope. Let me see if you nailed this song or not.
Made in a garage.
Yeah. Do you watch American Idol?
No, kind of a little bit. I started recently just because Steven Tyler was on there.
Why does no one admit to watching? I watch it. Robin says, oh, I just pass by it. Everyone I know passes by it.
So
I
you're, like, admit. You're committed. You like to watch it.
I love it.
You have a favorite.
I vote.
What? Are you gonna, you call and vote?
That's right. Listen.
Who you vote
for? I'm an American. If you don't vote, then you can't complain about who your idol is.
What did you think about the Pia girl getting...
Disgraceful. She had real sex appeal. She had the good look. I liked her. But I didn't vote that week, and I blame myself.
Right. But right. You know what's going to happen now? She's going to be the most famous one of them all. Because
she already got a record.
It's never the winner. It's the person who...
Right. Yeah. Who wants to win American Idol?
I'm calling for hearings, investigating what went wrong. So you do watch it. You watch it for Steven Tyler.
I have...
Did you first think Steven Tyler made a terrible mistake because he's so iconic? I mean, he's Steven Tyler. He's a brilliant musician, one of my favorites.
Sure.
Did you think it was kind of a sellout that he went to American Idol?
I didn't think it was a sellout. I just thought it was, I thought it was strange. I thought, shouldn't he be doing an Aerosmith record or something? What? And then I watched it and I understood why they want him on the show.
I understand
he's
why,
perfect for the show.
I understand why they want him. It gives them a tremendous credibility, yeah. But why does he want to? And what if I told you, I'll tell you why.
Oh.
Because I know people. He did it for the money.
Think so?
Not think so. Know it.
Was it? Is it tons of bread?
It's about $15 million a year.
Holy moly.
And he needed the bread. Now, why does a guy in Aerosmith
do that?
Yeah, you would do it.
That's Nirvana money.
Yeah. He got money. $15 million. J-Lo got around. I happen to know she did it for the money, too. She needed the money.
I can understand that.
She didn't need the money.
Come on. I mean, these are people who made a lot of money, right?
I'll fill you in.
How much
afterwards.
Do you need?
No, no, no. She needed it.
Got a high lifestyle there. She's not
I
in a
know
crack
everything.
Home.
I have dossiers on people.
Oh, my God.
That's right. Randy, the other judge,
yeah,
he gets $300 an episode. Free and clear. They even pay his taxes.
The musician of the group.
All right. Here we go. Let me listen to a little of the boys playing some of their music here. Let's see what we have. Have on our hands here with rope. This part I like.
Psychedelic.
Is song. That you?
That's me.
I like that part.
Unconventional chord.
But this could go wrong.
Oh, I like this.
That's
bouncing
heavy.
Around.
It's a headphones
yes.
record.
Yeah.
Ready? Yeah. Wear headphones. Shaking my head. Now we're in the garage.
Here we go. Taylor's the high voice.
I'm the girl.
You mean the girl part?
Gravity is waiting on the fall. How did this come over me?
Nice. I like it. a winner. It's a winner. I'm not bullshitting you. It's a winner.
Thank you.
Cool.
You're on to something with that one.
That's
I like
our first
it.
Single.
Now, when you say a single, where the hell do you go to play this? All the rock stations are almost gone. You got KROQ in Los Angeles. We'll play it. I don't even know in New York if there's a rock station left. Is there? There's only classic rock.
I don't really know how it works anymore, but I know that the, like DC lost HFS.
Yeah, it's almost like, why even bother putting on a single?
Isn't there an alternative station?
Satellite, I guess.
Satellite.
You know,
well, we'll play it. We have 50 stations that'll play it.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Real quick, a couple of questions, and then I'll let you guys out of here, and you can go back to your kids. Joe, go ahead. You're on the air.
Hey, Howard. How you doing? Is that Dave?
What's up, Joe?
It's Dave and Taylor.
I got to just Taylor. I just wanted to tell Dave, man, that on that Paul McCartney tribute, you fucking smoked the house. You were like the
Why are you laughing when he says that? That's true. I have to see.
Because he said, you fucking smoked the house.
Well, you did smoke it.
Thanks. That's why I'm laughing.
Was that a thrill for you? I mean, I love
it. Yeah, is that fun?
Are the Beatles your inspiration? Were they the reason?
They were the first band I ever really loved.
You didn't appear to be nervous at all playing in front of that crowd. Paul McCartney.
The Kennedy Center thing?
Yeah, Obama, the whole thing. You didn't. You just get out there and you do it. Were you?
No, I'm pretty nervous.
You were?
I always get nervous.
How does that manifest?
That ass kicking, that was fucking incredible.
How does that
Thanks, Joe.
How does nervous? Thank you, Joe. How does that nervousness manifest itself?
Like on SNL,
right?
See how I was spazzing out so hard, I was snapping my neck around.
Now you were comfortable because you were with Foo Fighters, you were with the band.
But it's still kind of nerve wracking to do things like that.
Oh yeah, it's
but
scary.
To do like,
is it? You still get nervous about that?
Oh.
Even Saturday Night Live, really?
It's the worst. That's the one that you get most nervous about.
See, people are shocked to hear that. Like, when I go on Letterman, the reason I don't do it, I do it like every 5 years.
Do you get nervous?
I hate it. It's not nerves. It's just I put a lot into it, and I want it to go off properly.
You can't relax.
I don't relax, and it ruins my week. It ruins the whole fucking
absolutely.
Week.
That's
I could just go on.
Now, when they tell us, okay, you guys got SNL, that's 2-3 months from now. I'm just nervous
every
for
day.
Months.
And when you think about it, like, your balls shift and your asshole goes.
I never thought that of you guys.
You think musicians have the song to hang on to.
Oh, yeah. And I'm like, you guys have done it a million times, and what's
the
difference?
Yeah, but if we fuck that song up on SNL,
live,
in front of everybody.
Like, you're right.
An you Ashley moment, or like, I faint and fall on my face.
Well, you're right. If you trip, it's going to be all over the news. And not only that, if they fuck up the sound, because you guys don't lip sync, because you actually play live, I noticed the sound was very good on Saturday Night Live this week. A lot of times I've seen guys get screwed.
Yeah.
Got screwed. Remember that?
Did he?
Yeah.
We got a guy named JC that works for us, and he's sort of like the Obi-Wan Kenobi of our whole scene. And he goes in there and he sits in there with the sound guys and the camera guys.
He's worth his weight in gold because that can really screw you up. All right, take one more.
Wait a minute. I want to know what Taylor's spitting.
I'm dipping.
Oh, are you chew?
Oh, God.
Yeah, I quit smoking.
But that chew, though, will give you mouth cancer.
Well, I know. I'm tapering.
This is a tapering off kind of thing?
It's better than smoking.
No kidding. You like that tape? Man, that's hardcore.
It's fucking gross. It's the
Dave, you don't
thing
chew, do
world.
You?
No.
You love him because he does all the wrong things.
He does all the things that I shouldn't be doing.
Right. You admire him because
watch.
You're so under control. No drugs, no this, no that. He does everything, and you admire it. You
want, and I just sit and laugh.
You live vicariously
what a
through
dumb
him.
Shit.
Is he your Joe Perry in a sense? Because I noticed Steven Tyler, when he performs, he has one. Joe and him, they look cool together. I see you like the way. You like his
whole
aura.
He and I are definitely best friends and have a good connection musically. And, you know, when we're on stage, I probably spend most of the time focused on Taylor. And,
right.
You know,
because he has the look, right?
When we met,
he has the look.
He what? Does. Like,
he just loves
look?
Looking
looks
at me.
He, just he takes his shirt off and he's got
literally
this
when we met,
hot pecs.
You know what? He has a man crush on you, and I don't give a fuck what anyone says. Am I right or am I
wrong?
And
forth, it's back and forth. When we met,
you guys ever touch each other's penises?
Just that one time.
Take it easy.
Is it a bromance?
You guys have a bromance, right?
The day we met, it was like long lost brothers,
right?
It really was.
You know,
right away.
People don't like to admit this, but a band, a lot of it has to do with luck. I don't give a fuck that you're in Nirvana.
He picked him because of his looks.
No, listen, he's a dynamite drummer. I mean, you can really.
Okay.
I mean, I've watched you. You're fantastic. And you,
thanks,
but
Howard.
Yes, Dave has a crush on Taylor. He does. Listen, if I had to date a man, it would be either one of these two guys. Why not? I like it. It's about the look. You still have to look cool when you're up on stage.
Well, it's got a nice personality, too.
But you have to have a cool, youthful look. Like, I was looking at Dave on TV. You got the long hair, but it's still dark. You don't have any gray.
Not yet.
You know, you look youthful. You have to, you know?
Thanks.
That's it. Which one of these two guys would you fuck, Robin?
Oh, my God.
Would you
Here
fuck
we
Dave
go.
Or Taylor? I'm based
I'll
on...
I'll fuck both of them.
Oh. Good for you.
That's going to be quite a night.
One last question.
That's going to be quite a night.
Maybe we could touch penises. We've never done it before. I mean,
it's going to get weird.
Yeah.
You guys ever see each other naked?
Oh, I don't know.
No, all right.
Yeah. Wally, go ahead. You have the last word, and then I'm going to let the boys out of here.
Oh, hey. Thanks for taking my call, Howard. These guys are my Beatles, but I just want to know, on the Stern Show Shuffle, they had Courtney Love, that Hall on there talking shit that Dave wrote that song Hero about Kurt, and I heard him.
The song Hero was about Kurt?
No, not really.
Who was it about? Who was my hero?
I sort of wrote that song about about this friend of mine, this guy Pete Stahl.
Pete Stahl?
Yeah, Pete Stahl.
What is
Pete
Stahl?
I was in a band with him years ago. He was this dude that, like, basically, he was my mentor. When I first dropped out of high school, I joined his band, and he taught me how to make it on the road.
And what is... I'm not following that. What is Pete Stahl?
Pete.
Pete is
Pete.
His name.
Oh, Pete Stahl.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
I thought it was a disease. Some guy you had, Pete Stahl.
Something you get on your feet.
He was your hero because he showed you the ropes.
Yeah, he's just like a good dude, you know?
Whenever I hear that song, I think about my dad.
Really?
Yeah.
Good.
There goes your hero.
Because that's what
because,
it's, yeah,
because
it should be
I think
like
about
that.
When I was a little boy, I worshipped him because he was my dad. And there goes my. I get emotional thinking about it. All right. I'm going to pass off. I'm going to go on. Don't ever sing that song around me. Make
I
me
won't.
Like
I promise.
Don't cry.
I don't want to see Howard Stern
I'm
cry.
Very fucking much. He might have come the closest to get me to cry with that song. All right, listen.
Next
Dave
time.
Grohl, Taylor Hawkins, you two guys are some of my favorite people.
It's good to be back, Howard.
I'm
we
glad
shouldn't
to have
wait
you
so long next
yeah.
time.
Yeah.
You're a busy man. I even said, I don't know with these Foo Fighters. Very
we
busy.
We didn't even know you were going to show up today.
Yeah, I said, I don't know. But I'm so glad you came in.
Thanks.
I wish you a lot of success with the new record. I guess you're going to be on tour everywhere, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Foo Fighters' new album, Wasted Light, featuring the single Rope, is in stores tomorrow. For additional information and tour dates, go to foofighters.com. Very important website that you must be on. Boys, anything you want to say to the audience before you leave? I'll leave it with the last words. Taylor, anything?
Oh, man. Thanks for hanging with us for frickin' 16 years. It's insane. We're so lucky.
We're so lucky that we get to go play shows to so many people now. We never expected that. We didn't think this would last this long, and it's nice that people still love rock and roll.
That's great, and I'm happy for you. You're really good guys.
Dave, there seems to be this mutual respect between you and Howard that goes back a long way. You said you credit him with really putting you guys over
honestly,
the
honestly, man, that time when we went and did the acoustic version of Everlong on the air, which wasn't really planned. Someone said, there'll be a guitar there for you in case he asks you to play a song. And I'd never performed one of our songs acoustic, I don't think.
Oh, okay.
And that was the only one that seemed like it would work. And he just started playing shit out of it.
Okay. You guys kind of
captured
the
everywhere.
It was kind of like an impromptu thing.
No, it was great. That's what it's all about. It was awesome.
What do you respect most about Howard? And, you know, you guys keep coming back, and, you know, it seems like this is going to keep going for a long time, your relationship.
Well, you know, he seems like a genuinely nice dude. And I know that he's got this bad boy reputation, but he's always seemed like a really good dude. And he loves music.
Plus, he did it his way.
Yeah.
Like, he does
a lot of integrity.
Every single thing his way. He did not fucking back down ever. When you watch that movie, I love that movie.
Yeah.
Private Parts. I just did it his way.
Well, it's sort of like you guys have learned to say, like you were saying just earlier, fuck you to some of the people trying to make you do all these appearances and do all things. You're doing it on your own terms.
Yeah, I think he's done the same thing.
Yeah.
So fuck you.
Good luck, guys.
Bye.